terrace isn't the kind of house you'd probably build today. It's outlived the age that gave it shape. It came to life during a time of great contrast. There were the poor and the very rich. It was 1931. Herbert Hoover was president. There was prohibition, flappers, deco art, and there was a depression that wiped the smile from the face of America. It was possible then to build a great house because there were artisans who took their task as if it were to be their own monument. It was then, in that gentler, slower time, here at 12 Lakeshore Drive in Grosse Pointe Farms, that Anna Thompson Dodge built her great French chateau and named it Rose Terrace. The artisans built well with steel and brick and stone and marble. It was not whimsy, for her or for them. It was not an exercise in vulgar, eager spending. It was a dream. For the artisans, the fulfillment of all they had arduously learned. For a simple girl from Scotland, married to a poor mechanic, who struck it rich as America took to wheels, it was a statement of what is possible in America. Horace Dodge died in 1920, and the Dodge millions came to Anna. It was the end of the simple life, the beginning, really, of Rose Terrace. By 1926, she had met and married the dashing Hugh Dillman. They traveled to France, Russia, England, and the Orient. She saw the great French palaces. It started a lifelong love affair with the 18th century. She studied them carefully, and she learned well, so that by the time she was ready to build such a house here, she knew more of what was correct than the designers and artisans. It's amazing she started it. She was, after all, then in her 60s. But she never wavered in her search for excellence. She knew what she wanted, and she wasn't easy to please. She sifted through hundreds of designs until she found the one by the famous Philadelphia architect Horace Trumbauer. She was ready. And in 1931, work started. It was to take 4 years. The building of the house put thousands back to work in those bleak days. Detroit steel mills opened to make the steel for the frame. Marble and stone quarries were started up again. Men could be proud to work once more, and work they did. And when they had finished, Rose Terrace stood at the edge of the lake, a $7 million dream filled with a king's ransom of treasures of the 18th century. It was the finest of its type in the country, but it was also a curiosity here in a busy, bustling America. It was regarded as an anachronism, oddly out of time and sequence. It stood proud, a magnificent alien on the land. Later, it would be called a museum by some, by others, pretentious. But all agree, there are no others like it. Its great limestone walls rise up sharp and precise, and its two wings reach out toward the lake like a castle waiting for its king. To enter is to know that in it is the spirit of kings. Anna Dodge loved Rose Terrace, and when she was here, it was not cold, as some people said. It often rang with the happy squeals of her grandchildren. They loved her and called her affectionately Mama. Later, she gave her granddaughters their dazzling debuts here in the fabulous 18th century music room. The kings of France, Louis XIV, XV, and XVI, are all represented here. The paneling is pure Louis XVI in 24-karat gold. The palace-sized 22-by-48 Savonnerie carpet was woven in Aubusson, France, especially for this house. It's a room filled with wonders of craftsmanship and stands as one of the great collections of 18th-century art anywhere. The other rooms in the house will be sold at public auction, but all of this, enough to boggle the mind, will stay in Detroit. Mama willed it to the Detroit Institute of Art, along with $1 million to house it. The rarest and most valuable piece is the jewel cabinet, made by the French ebonist or cabinet maker Martin Carlin in the 1770s. It once stood in the bedroom of Maria Feodorovna, Empress of Russia. There are royal Sèvres porcelain plaques laid over the rare woods. And ormolu, bronze fired with a layer of gold at the edges. It's priceless. Ormolu is everywhere. The fire dogs made by Pierre Gautier. The wall sconces over the mantle that once belonged to Marie Antoinette. This same precious material. The room is mostly the work of Baron Joseph Devine, the famous antiquaire and art dealer, who helped Mama scour the world in search of just the right piece for the right place in the house. It consumed several years of his life and of hers. In here is the staggering and priceless collection of Royal Sèvres porcelains that stand in four gilt cabinets on either side of the room. This amazing porcelain originated at Saint-Cloud when an artist named Morin discovered an artificial soft paste. The manufactory was later moved to the little town of Sèvres. By 1759, King Louis XV was the sole owner, and it became the accepted gift of kings to ambassadors and lords and ladies. The various colors have never been excelled, many never equaled. In her way, Mama was as fantastic as the house she built. She was simple, yet a queen. She could be affectionate and then stern. She would lash out in anger and quickly forgive. Her Scottish blood ran deep. She was fiercely loyal, and she commanded great loyalty from those around her. Gustav Vandenbrandt came to help build this house in 1931, and when it was finished, he stayed. Over the years, the warmth between this amazing woman and her faithful retainer has become almost legend. Gustav knows more about this house and the things in it than anyone living. He still helps keep the treasures in a state of repair, like the piano made in England that once belonged to the children of King George III. It's magnificent, but it'll no longer keep in tune. There's a Chinese harp and the great symphonic organ that once belonged to Horace Dodge Sr. It was reassembled from the old red house that once stood on this property. In the years before she was rich, Mama gave piano lessons in Detroit. And then later, she played this organ. It was last played by her grandson David for her funeral. The pipes for the organ are everywhere, from the third floor servants' quarters to the basement. Sound comes from behind the many tapestries in the house, mainly from this tapestry by Francois Boucher of Psyche displaying her treasures. And appropriately enough, it depicts a great abundance of wealth. It hangs above one of three matching settees covered in Beauvais tapestry. These were designed by Henri Salembier for the great French statesman Talleyrand. And this, together with the 10 matching pieces, were on display at the Metropolitan Museum of Art before they came into Mrs. Dodge's collection. One of the most fascinating pieces is this little writing table, or escritoire. It's signed by the cabinet maker to Louis XVI, Roger Van de Cruz Delacroix. And it's the earliest signed piece in the collection. What makes it so fascinating is the spring-loaded mechanism. It's still functional, even after 200 years. They did their work well. The 18th century artist had an incredible eye for detail. This terracotta statue was done by Claude Michel. He was known as Clodion. This depicts a mythical character running with a fawn and an infant. Its detail is amazing. Lord Devine said that no civilized person should live without a British 18th century portrait in his house. At Rose Terrace, there are scores. Above this parquet commode, done by another cabinet maker to the king, Henri Reisner, hangs one of two very important portraits by Thomas Gainsborough. They depict the Duke and Duchess of Hamilton. They were bought in 1925 by Lord Devine from descendants of the family, and he sold them to Mrs. Dodge. music room, The Girl with a Kitten by Sir Joshua Reynolds, The Portrait of Lady Rowley by John Hoppner, and in the ladies' powder room, The Young Girl Reading a Letter by the French 18th century artist Jean-Baptiste Greuze. There are four paintings attributed to Jean-Baptiste Douay, a student of Boucher. These have caused something of a controversy in the art world. Some say they were actually the work of Fragonard, the master. In any event, they were painted in 1753. One of them hangs here in the beautiful breakfast room which faces the lake, where in the old days, Mama usually had breakfast and lunch with the family and children gathered at the solid marble table. And one can almost still hear her say, as she often did in those days to the children during a lull in the conversation, "Sit up, you're slouching." And everyone, adults included, would suddenly sit erect. Her voice had that kind of authority. Like her house, her bearing was regal as a monarch's, and she wanted everyone to have good posture. Mama loved things massive. In the dining room, for instance, hangs the overwhelming portrait of Mountjoy Blunt, 1st Earl of Newport. It was painted around 1620 by Sir Anthony Van Dyck, who had been a student of Rubens and later portraitist of the British aristocracy. His arrogant look seems oddly appropriate. The dining room says much about Anna Dodge. It says that here lived a woman who demanded that which is best in our world. Its oak paneling is warm and richly intricate, yet with a strength of iron. Mama was thoroughly dedicated to this dream of hers. To find the soft, mellow texture in the panels, a search was started to find the perfect wood. That search ended in Greece. 900 Greek barns were torn down and the woods matched for grain and quality. Then they were shipped to France, where the finest woodworkers carved and shaped them. And then they came to Rose Terrace and installed them. The effect is glorious. In this room in the evenings when she was in residence, there were parties. It might be a small supper for six, or a banquet for 24. Then the crystal and silver gilt were brought out of the vault. Candles glowed softly in their candelabrum, and there was laughter. Standing here, one can almost hear the voices that gave Rose Terrace in those days the life it was built to contain. Mama loved laughter, and those who knew her said she was quite a wit. She had taken such a joy in building Rose Terrace, she took equal joy in sharing it with her friends. Though she herself had simple tastes, she loved macaroni and cheese and ice cream. For her friends, the food rivaled anything at the Palace of Versailles. There might be bone squab and champagne, galantine of turkey with baked oranges and beluga caviar, and always flowers, sometimes flown in from Florida for the occasion. The great crystal chandelier sparkled, throwing light across Mama's dream, making it for the moment real. But there was a cold wind gathering at the edges of Rose Terrace. It was time. It stirred softly against the faces of the gracious ladies, the stalwart men, until it blew the holocaust of World War II across them, chilling the flame and darkening the wine. And then they came no more. Time closed their world in a harvest of age. What makes Rose Terrace so fascinating are the little touches here and there one would hardly expect to find. Like the elevator, it's a small jewel in a treasure trove of riches, delicately hand-painted with Chinese embroidered silk behind glass. It runs from the basement to the second floor. It's just one of the many modern conveniences built to fit in with the 18th century style of the house. There's also a central vacuum cleaning system, an automatic ice maker, and seven vaults made to hold silver, jade, furs, linen, and bric-a-brac. If you count all of the rooms in the house, there are 240. Seven guest bedrooms here on the second floor, an east wing suite, and a west wing suite. Everywhere in the house are things Mama loved. This piece of jade she brought back in a suitcase from China. She loved it so well. The west wing suite belonged to Mama. She died in this bedroom on June 2nd, 1970, at the age of 103. It was one of her lifelong ambitions, she said, to pass 100. Ren Banam would serve Mrs. Dodge since she was very young, was here that night. She's here still, and will be until all of this is stripped for auction. She watches over it, as she always has. The little things Mama loved so dearly are here. A small piece of porcelain, part of her jade collection, and the sweetheart roses that were her favorite flowers. Not great riches, but things that held memories for her. And the room, of course, would befit a queen, and those who knew her said she was. Even her bath is a small masterpiece of carved Belgian marble and gold. No detail is missing. Mama made sure of that. The lakefront sitting room is where Mama spent most of her time in the last 2 years of her life. She'd sit here in the midst of this Louis XV splendor, watching her favorite TV programs, mostly Western. Her favorite actor was Bonanza's Lorne Greene. Or she'd play solitaire. Card playing was a lifelong pastime. From her chair here in the corner, she could look out toward the gray house that had belonged to her son, Horace. All her yesterdays were here. Memories of a trip to China in the 1920s when she started her famous jade collection. Much of it is here in the sitting room. There are exquisite little figures in all colors of jade. Some are quite unusual. A little tear bottle. In ancient times, Chinese women would fill these with their own tears when their husbands were away to show how much they missed them. The room now, anyway, looks as if Anna Dodge had just gotten up to leave for a few moments. So much of her is here. Her strong Scottish will has been stamped on it indelibly, and one cannot separate the house from the woman. In every way, it's a woman's house. There's nothing here that fits a man. The little details of a woman are everywhere. It's a woman's stairway, lovingly carved from Italian marble. Its wrought iron sweeps like the curve of a lady. Its treads covered in a rich savonnery carpet. When her grandchildren were here, Mama made them walk on only the borders because she said she wanted to save the beautiful blue center part. It was part of her Scottish upbringing. So down they'd come, single file, trooping past the great porcelain Chinese temple vases, under another of the massive Boucher tapestries. And then, in military steps, they'd come bobbing around over the head of the statue of Venus and Cupid, sculptured in 1766 by Gerard Gautier for Madame de Pompadour. It has been said that it takes a long time to bring excellence to maturity. Anna Dodge spent a lifetime doing it. The result is Rose Terrace. She was tremendously sure of herself. Once, when the workers had put up giant steel girders from the basement to the third floor, Mama came and stood out front and said they were the wrong height, and she made them tear them down and start again. Then she had a platform built to show them what she wanted. Mama's vision was not to be tampered with. Later, even the architect said she was correct. The proportions of the house are almost perfect. These massive ionic columns and the walls are made of cane stone, put up rough, and then carved and polished here by stone cutters. It's a soft stone and can only be found in one place in France. It's doubtful if you could find it today. Certain you couldn't find the artisans to carve it. If, as they say, Anna Dodge was a queen, she's in great company here. The Dowager Empress of Russia, Maria Fyodorovna, Marie Antoinette, the beguiling Madame de Pompadour, and the Empress Catherine of Russia. Their ghosts are all in this house. In the center of the great hall is the table of Catherine II, and perhaps her uneasy spirit hovers here, admiring again the fabulous ormolu work of Philippe Caffieri, as she must have when it stood in her palace at St. Petersburg. And if there's a stirring of spirits, a gathering of those gallant ghosts, perhaps the small breath of Marie Antoinette blows over these magnificent monumental candelabra, as it did when they stood in the palace at Versailles. Maybe they salute Etienne Maurice Falconet, who made them so rich in surface and color, and who decorated them so sumptuously. Whispering through Rose Terrace, the royal host would surely assemble in the two hallways on either side of the great vestibule to chuckle and chortle in glee with Madame de Pompadour when, with Louis wrapped securely around her finger, she commissioned Francois Boucher in 1748 to paint two enormous paintings for the king's birthday. Oh, how she must have laughed. They're too precious for a king. And the king himself is here, looking amused, thinking of another birthday, 1772, 2 years before his death, when Jean-Baptiste Lemoyne carved his likeness in marble. Maybe Louis smiled, knowing it would outlast the Pompadour. Yet after brick and steel and stone are gone, and flesh and blood are dust, the dream lives on. In a sense, life tends to be circular, a round trip. Anna Thompson Dodge made hers, and now these things she gathered from the far corners of the world, the rare Kangxi porcelains, the bronzes, the limited editions, the little art objects that seem to fulfill her, will start their journey back, and perhaps they'll find the love that Anna Dodge gave them. But Rose Terrace, gracious lady that she is, has been charged with enormous taxes, zoning restrictions, and high maintenance costs. She's been found guilty on all counts. Unless a sponsor can be found from among her many admirers, this great mansion, one of a kind, a work of art in its own right, will be sentenced to destruction. She'll have as final executioner a crane wielding a massive steel ball, which will pound these fine walls and Mama's dream to rubble.